Hello, my name is Torsten Opper. I'm a curator in the Department of Greece and Rome here in the British Museum. Welcome to my corner. One of my interests and specialisms really is Roman portraiture or ancient portraiture in general. I love ancient sculpture. I find portraits quite intriguing. What we could do today is just look at ways we can study a portrait head like this. What we should be looking out for, what the key questions are, how you contextualize it, how you turn it back from a dead object into something meaningful that carries a message, and how we can really put ourselves in the position of a Roman who would have looked at this at the time. There's a lot of background that we can bring to bear, and that makes it really fascinating. For me, there are different aspects. It's not even about how naturalistic they are. It's what the message they were meant to carry and how to decode that. So there's your immediate gut reaction. If you look at a portrait, you have a face of someone. So there's a meeting, metaphorically speaking, of individuals. And you know, even that is quite powerful. Gazing into the eyes of Nero now is something special. But it's the little coded messages. It's reconstructing how it would have looked, imagining what type of body it sat on, how you were meant to see it. Just going right in, it's a portrait of the Emperor Nero, who reigned from AD 54 to 68. Over his lifetime, Nero had four different portrait types. Portrait types are usually created for a specific occasion. In the exhibition, the first statue of Nero you'll see shows him as a boy, 12, 13 years old. That's probably when he was adopted by Claudius and built up as a successor. So that was the first occasion where he needed to be known to by the Roman public, where his images were produced and put out there. The next big occasion was in AD 54, when he became emperor after Claudius' death. This portrait here, a bronze head, clearly belongs to Nero's second type, so the type created in AD 54. The third type came in AD 59 for his 5-year anniversary on the throne, and then probably the last type in AD 64 for his 10-year anniversary on the throne. These are the big occasions that mark an emperor's reign. This gives us a fairly good indication when this was produced, AD 54 to 59, roughly. Often they only had coins, so two-dimensional sources. The model they had when they made this bronze version of the head. The profile is very clear, and it compares very closely to inscribed coin portraits of Nero. That's how you identify portraits of Roman emperors, really. The coins are very clear, they're named, and they give us dates of offices, so we know who it is and roughly when the portrait was created. It's a bronze head, bronze-copper alloy. These have very rarely survived from antiquity. There are only one or two other Nero portraits in bronze that have survived, so ours is very special. This is a life-sized, roughly life-sized head. You can probably compare my head to the bronze portrait. The measure for comparison usually is chin to top of the head, chin to crown. In this case, that's about 23 centimeters, which is considered just about life size. Most Roman portraits, ancient portraits, are taller. They look slightly funny, and I think you can appreciate it from where you sit now. It's an odd shape to the face. There's this small pointed chin, which is quite typical for Nero, but is accentuated here. The protruding ears are quite significant. You find those in many Nero portraits. One thing that's immediately obvious is that the eye sockets are empty. That's the way the head was cast. They were originally filled with coloured stone, coloured glass. Sometimes in a local northwestern province context, they can be enamelled. I think here it was probably stone. So you'd have a white eyeball and a proper dark iris and pupil. So very lifelike. One of our other great objects in the British Museum is the Meroe head of Augustus. That's one of the very few heads that have survived from antiquity with the original inlet eyes. And that's roughly how I have to imagine our Nero here. Now, as we said, the proportions of the face look a little bit unusual, especially at eye height. It changes when you see him from below. You need to remember that this was part of a statue originally, so it would have been seen from below at an angle. We've only, in the run-up to our exhibition, commissioned new photographs after a lot of discussion, and they're taken from a lower angle, and straight away it changes the proportions. He looks a lot more authoritative and imperious in that way. What I also found quite interesting, because only the frontal view is usually online or in books, I'll turn it slightly into profile. And I don't know what you think, but it looks a lot more Roman to me in profile. And fantastic that the nose is preserved. You don't often get that with marble statues. When they fall over, the nose is the first thing to go. It's here. It has this typically Julio-Claudian form. It's slightly aquiline, so rarely preserved. You can see that it's very broken here. We'll come back to why that is. I'll turn it a little around for you so you can see what we have here is the original neckline. And I've read some of the reports that were done of it, the scientific examination. There's some traces of solder at the back of the neck. And that indicates that the whole statue was cast in different parts. It's often easier to do it that way, that it was linked to a body there. Now, you don't want an unsightly solder line visible, so that's a clear indication that the body was draped in a toga, the official Roman costume, if you like, or more likely in this case with Nero and an emperor in military body armor. Roman portraits, an important thing is really the messages they carry. And they're not, we're now used to used to selfies or to passport photographs. So it's really the face that matters. In official Roman portraiture, it's the whole body. So it matters if you're in the toga, for example, that shows you're a Roman citizen. If you're in military armor, whether you're standing, whether you're on horseback, whether you're sitting, you know, these all carry messages. The inscription is very important for context. All this is lost here. We really only have the face. But we can painfully reconstruct sometimes. We can identify certain body types that may have gone with these statues. And that gives us a fuller meaning. It was discovered in spring 1907 by a local schoolboy in the muddy bed of the River Alde in Suffolk. Someone local bought it off that schoolboy, Mr. Holland, and displayed it. But a year later, in 1908, it came to London for the first time. It was displayed by the Society of Antiquaries, and they had one of their regular meetings, and they discussed it. And we have minutes of the meeting, and it was identified straight away as a Roman portrait of the Julio-Claudian period. So the Julio-Claudians are the imperial family from Augustus to Nero, the first five Roman emperors. But the identification was quite open. You have to understand at that time, portraits weren't really researched. There weren't many publications with photographs for comparisons and so on. So different names were put forward. In 1915, there was a first article that linked the head to Claudius in particular. Other names had been mentioned before, his predecessor, other princes of the period. And it linked it to Claudius, but also to Colchester, the Roman capital at the time. Colchester is about 40 miles to the southwest of the find spot. It was heavily corroded when it was found. It's now been cleaned and conserved. There are only small bits where we can get an idea of the original surface. According to the scientific reports, here above the right eye, there's an area where you have a little bit of the original black patina left. But clearly, it's quite well preserved, other than the physical damage it suffered when it was torn down. That's also an indication that it probably wasn't on display for very long. If it was made the earliest in AD 54, maybe ripped down in AD 60, 61, that gives you a fairly short window for how long this would have been out on display. You see quite savage marks on the head. It was clearly hit from the right with a sharp implement here. You can see a very deep indentation and holes as well. It was probably stuck repeatedly. And also here at the back, I mean, you see it better in profile. You can probably see a dent here. It hasn't pierced the bronze, but someone whacked it really hard. Why would they do that? With Nero, there are two possible scenarios. After his death through enforced suicide in AD 68, many of his statues were toppled over and removed. There was something we now call, it's a modern term really, damnatio memoriae, the condemnation of his memory. So that's his images were removed, destroyed, toppled, taken off display. His name was erased from inscriptions. So that's a potential scenario for this statue too. Although you wonder why it would then end up 40 miles to the north in a river. Doesn't really make sense. The other is, and that theory came up in 1914 for the first time, that it's linked to an event in Britain that was hugely significant in Nero's reign. That's the Boudica rebellion in AD 61. Britain had only been conquered. The core part of the province it's just been turned over to a civilian administration, but really all around it towards Wales and the north were tribal territories. There was ongoing warfare, and you have to think of the province as swarming with soldiers, with military contractors, with tax farmers. The sources tell us that there was a lot of uncontrolled exploitation. The locals were treated with great disrespect. Britain was one of the provinces where the Roman army and their commanders in particular could still hope to make booty like in the old days. That wasn't possible in other parts of the empire anymore. Boudica was the leader, the queen of the Iceni tribe. She'd taken over from her late husband. It seems that the Romans tried to take over Boudica's territory. That often happened. The system of rule was based on treaties with local rulers, but that didn't mean that you could pass on your kingdom, say, or your tribal territory to your descendants. Sometimes it was incorporated in the Roman province. That's what may have happened here. It's also reported that Romans suddenly called in loans, raised taxes, So there was great discontent that erupted in a violent rebellion against Roman rule. And the Iceni, led by Boudica and other allied tribes, went to the capital, to Camulodunum, Colchester, and sacked it. There were no city walls at the time. The Romans had to flee to the local temple, which was a giant temple of Claudius, the founder of Colchester, of Roman Colchester. They held out for 2-3 days, and then the whole place was burnt down, and they were all killed and slaughtered. The rebels moved on, or freedom fighters, moved on, sacked Londinium and Verulanium, modern St. Albans, and only afterwards were they defeated in battle. But the conflict was very brutal. The image of the emperor really stood in for the emperor himself, for the person of the emperor. So like you have Church Asylum now, you could go and hug the image of the emperor, and that would keep you safe for a while. So no surprise that there's a real hatred then, of course, that is taken out on the statue as well. Why the River Alt? So what's it about the find spot and the background? I said the River Alt is in Suffolk. In antiquity, in the Roman period, it may have formed the border between tribal territories, between the Iceni to the north in Norfolk and the Trinovantes just to the south. That's the tribal formation around Colchester. So one possibility is that the Iceni or Trinovantes, during the rebellion, tore the statue down, hacked off the head, highly symbolic, maybe took it off, and then ritually deposited in the river. A well-established tradition in the Northwest provinces are these water deposits. Jewelry, booty, a lot of weapons. Also in the Thames, for example, they found lots of skulls, so it's highly symbolic. And putting it in that river, if that river also was a tribal boundary, probably invests that boundary with added significance. Importantly, Nero now is associated with totally different values. Our image of Nero, and that's something we're trying to question in the exhibition, is a monster, a megalomaniac, a deluded artist. You can project that on an isolated head, but if you imagine him as a full statue, in military body armor, as commander in chief, the aura of the image is completely different. And that's really crucial, to go back to the way a Roman public in Nero's day would have seen his images.
Hello, I'm Mary Beard, and I'm glad you can join me to explore some of my favourite things in the British Museum exhibition, Nero, the Man Behind the Myth. I'm standing here in the first main section of the show. As you come into it, you pass a full-length statue of a young boy, well, 12 or 13 years old, clad in a toga. He is actually the young Nero, and he's an important reminder to us that Nero, well, he wasn't 13 when he came to the throne, but he was not much more. He was about 16, and he was, in other words, a boy emperor. As you come round the corner, you come and meet his family. And very important amongst his family are the women of the imperial house. And perhaps most important of all is Nero's mother, Agrippina. Now, she was the last wife of the Emperor Claudius, who was Nero's predecessor on the throne. And it is always said that Agrippina wangled Nero onto the throne in preference to the legitimate natural children of Claudius himself. She was the power behind the throne. Here you see her looking actually very beautiful. There's an absolutely gorgeous, miniature, lustrous green stone portrait of Agrippina. A very nice symbol of the way imperial women get represented in all kinds of materials, in all kinds of shapes and sizes. Here, Agrippina looks out at you, all green. But there's one statue here, which I think it's quite easy to walk past, and it's actually a statue of Messalina, who was the previous wife of the Emperor Claudius before Agrippina. And she's rather special, and I want to show you a bit about her. Meet Messalina behind me. Now, Messalina's no direct relation of Nero at all, but she is the last but one wife of the Emperor Claudius, and she was followed by Agrippina, Nero's mother. What you see is a very stately lady, and I think for some people that's a bit of a surprise, because what Roman writers said about Messalina was frankly terrible. She was supposed to have been, well, adulterous is putting it mildly, and she was finally killed off by her husband Claudius after one of her more lurid escapades, and then he married Agrippina. But she doesn't look here as anything but a perfect Roman wife. She's clad in her stola, she is cradling her child, who must be Britannicus, Claudius's son, and it was poor little Britannicus who Nero kind of bypassed on his way to the throne. She's perfection. She is the wife of Claudius, the Roman emperor, as perfect mother. I have to say, little Britannicus does look a bit odd, but I think that's because he was quite heavily restored later. But there's a secret about this statue which you might not spot instantly, because actually the Roman sculptor has based this very closely on a famous 4th century BC statue, that's 500 years earlier, showing the goddess Peace holding her child Little Wealth. So he's taken the template of this famous statue and turned it into Messalina. Now, I think what's interesting about that is that it's showing you, it's underlining how these empresses, whatever stories you read about them in the scurrilous Roman texts, they could be seen as not just perfect mums, but pretty much close to the divine. Messalina here stands for peace, wealth, and prosperity. She doesn't stand for adultery. And the same is going to go for Agrippina, Nero's mum. This is Agrippina, Nero's mum, full size. Now, her reputation is about as bad as Messalina's. She's supposed to have schemed her son Nero onto the Roman throne, partly by murdering Claudius with a bowl of poisoned mushrooms. She is said to have had extreme influence over Nero when he was still a young ruler, such extreme influence that there were rumours that they had an incestuous relationship. And pretty soon, Nero is supposed to have got so fed up with Mum that he killed her. Now, how much of any of that is true, it's very hard to know. Part of it, at least, I'm pretty sure, is one of those kind of blame the woman stories. I mean, you know, we're very used to that in modern politics. You know, if you want to know why a prime minister or president is doing something you don't quite approve of, you blame the wife or the girlfriend. And part of that, I think, has landed on Agrippina and probably also on Messalina before. So I have more of a soft spot for her than you would gather if you read the histories of Tacitus or Suetonius. But this statue of her, for me, is really, really precious. It has come to the exhibition from Rome, although I have to tell you, it's a statue with a very complicated history, and its real head has actually ended up in Copenhagen, and this is an exact replica. But it's a statue in this really precious, hard, basanite black stone. We're so used to thinking about ancient statuary as if it was partly bronze, few precious stones, but largely white marble, that we forget there were these extraordinary versions in different sorts of stone. And I think that to a Roman viewer, whatever they thought about Agrippina, whether they believed the rumours or not, they would have recognised this as extremely precious. It is a really, really, really hard stone. This would have taken months and months to carve. And in a sense, it's that kind of simple signal, the enormous labour that it would have taken to make, that makes this shout out at you. This is a very expensive piece from the Roman royal family. But let's now escape from the really posh royal family and go and see something from a much more ordinary house in Pompeii. Ancient Rome was a theatrical culture. It wasn't just the Emperor Nero who was mad keen on the theatre. It was popular entertainment too. And I know we think of the Roman people as being more interested in gladiators than anything else, but actually they flocked to theatrical displays and drama of all kinds, from revivals of 5th century Greek tragedy to modern farces. And the very, very, very rich and the not quite so rich also took scenes from theatre and decorated their houses with them. And this is a great example from a house in Pompeii, which shows you a scene from Euripides' play, Euripides, the 5th century BC Athenian dramatist, his play Iphigenia in Tauris, which told the story of the Greek princess Iphigenia, who had been sacrificed by her father Agamemnon in order to get a fair wind from the gods on his way to the Trojan War. But no one really knew what actually happened to Iphigenia. There are loads of stories. Euripides tells the story of her becoming a temple attendant, a priestess on the Black Sea. And here she is, the daughter of Agamemnon, now holding court in her temple, but not for very much longer, because her brother, Orestes, with his friend Pylades, has come to look for her and is about to rescue her. Now, it's quite interesting from a female point of view, because so many of Euripides' tragedies centred on a female main character. And here we see that female main character, but now replicated on the walls of a house at Pompeii. We think of Pompeii as a very ordinary little Roman town, and in some ways that's exactly what it was. But there were clearly some people with money here. I mean, it took quite a lot of money to have painting in this kind of style. But you can go even further than that. And some of the villas outside the city have produced really exquisite, valuable silver treasure. And one of the highlights of this show is part of a treasure from a place called Morigina, just outside Pompeii. And it is the silver dinner service of someone with a very great deal of money. The silver treasure from Morigina really is splendid, but it does play a bit into our image of the Romans as rich and luxurious. Well, some of them certainly were, and actually, you can see in the Nero show some of the really exquisite bits of decoration from Nero's own palaces. But I've got a tip here. The Romans weren't all rich and luxurious, and you should always say to yourself, when you're looking at something like this treasure, who made it, who cleaned it, and who did the washing up? Now, among all the wonderful, precious and intriguing works of art in this exhibition, it might surprise you to know that this is my very favourite object of all. It looks a bit of a boring block of marble, that's what it is, and it's a tombstone. And the name of the dead person is inscribed on it, Claudia Ecloge. Who's she? You might say, so what? Well, actually, this is 99.9% certain the tombstone of Nero's wet nurse, who was called Ecloge. And she was also one of the people who took Nero off to be buried after he'd killed himself when the armies were rebelling against his rule. We're 99.9% certain because the biographer Suetonius, writing in the 2nd century AD, tells us her name, Ecloge. She was a slave. She certainly started out life as a slave when she was his nurse. Her name, Claudia Ecloge, suggests at a certain point she was given her freedom. Now, there's something for me which is kind of poignant about this. I mean, this is a real connection between Nero's nanny and us. This is where she was buried. Now, I don't want to be too sloppy and sentimental. I mean, I think that there are lots of nasty dictators in the world who have had very faithful nurses. But it still kind of just hits me that this is really Nero's nurse, the very woman who took him off at the last to bury him. So I hope that when people actually come and visit the exhibition, they don't walk past this ordinary block of marble, because it's not an ordinary block of marble at all. Thank you very much for joining me on this tour. It's been a pleasure to take you round. And if you come to the show itself, make sure you stop and have a good look at Claudia Ecloge. Thank you.
Hello, my name is Torsten Opper. I'm a curator in the Department of Greece and Rome here at the British Museum and curator of the Nero Show.
And I'm Francesca Bologna, and I'm the project curator of this show. I'm very happy to welcome you to this exhibition, Nero, the Man Behind the Myth, supported by BP. Nero is the most infamous Roman emperor, the last of the Julio-Claudians, and to these days, his name is connected with cruelty, excesses, matricide, murder, the great fire of Rome. But actually, how much of these are lies? And how can we tell fact from fiction?
As Francesca said, all we think we know about Nero is based on a very narrow range of ancient sources. And they were all written by elite authors hostile to Nero. We see an expression of this here in the exhibition prequel in the foyer. There's an object from the Musei Capitolini in Rome that's very famous now again because it's linked to the Wikipedia entry on Nero. And if you look closely, you see that only a very small part of the face is actually ancient. The rest is a brilliant restoration, technically highly accomplished, done in the late 17th century and extremely well researched. He's really the cruel tyrant. He looks mean and exactly how you expect. And this is an interpretation of the literary source record. There are about 220 objects from all over the Roman Empire, including many new finds. And they give us different information. They're the voices of those who didn't write the literary sources. They help us to balance a lot of that record. We know that after his death, Nero was still very popular. The common people put flowers on his grave. There were imposters in the east of the empire pretending to be Nero and gathering a mass following. So there is a contrast between that and what the sources tell us. And that's really what the exhibition is all about, to find out more about the real or different Nero and the first century and what happened in Roman society during Nero's reign. We're now in the first section of the exhibition, the introduction. And one of our early decisions was to tell Nero's story, as it were, in real time, from the beginning to the end. Nothing was predetermined. There were always different outcomes possible. And beside me here is the first image we have of Nero. And it defies your expectations already. You remember the monster Nero we saw earlier in the prequel. And here's a little innocent boy. Even the statue is very small. We put him very low on the ground. Most visitors will tower over him. We can date that statue, which is now in the Louvre in Paris, probably comes from Rome or near Rome. We can date that statue fairly closely. It shows Nero as a 12 or 13-year-old boy. His mother, Agrippina, had just married the reigning emperor, Claudius, in 49. That is the first opportunity when his images were introduced to the public. And a year later, in AD 50, he was adopted as Claudius's successor and heir. Nero was born in December AD 37 as Lucius Domitius Ahenobarbus into a family closely related to the family of Augustus, the first emperor. If you look at this statue of Nero, the young boy, and these are the only statues, complete statues that have survived, you can get a sense of how the Roman public may have perceived him as a young prince. You could project all manner of expectations onto such a figure, and you can clearly see how powerful court factions might have thought they could dominate this young prince, use him as a puppet. Real history unfolded in quite a different way, as we will see. Nero was the fifth and last ruler of the Julio-Claudian dynasty, Rome's first dynasty, the family of Augustus. Augustus had won a brutal civil war about 80 years before Nero came to power. And he then introduced a completely new political system, the so-called Principate, the first man rule. The pretense was that he really had only restored the old republic, but in reality, the Principate was a monarchy in disguise. And that led to decades of conflict between the Senate that continued to exist and the imperial family. It was a constantly evolving compromise and improvisation. There were no clear rules, especially no clear rules for the succession. Every succession was troubled. Every transfer of power was challenged. This is the kind of background to Nero's reign. Roman society had undergone profound changes. The empire had hugely expanded during the Republic and during Augustus's rule. There were lots of new people that had to be accommodated and integrated. There were wealthy leading provincials that wanted to say in the Senate in Rome, and they started entering the Senate under Claudius. There were former slaves who became extremely wealthy and wanted to express their status as well. And this social aspiration among these people came up against status anxiety among the established elite. And these conflicts came to the fore during Nero's reign and ultimately led to the civil war that followed his death. Behind me, you see members of this ruling family, all the emperors and some of their wives and princesses. These are the main players. As I said, every transition was troubled. Augustus died aged 76. His successor, Tiberius, was challenged by a military mutiny. The successor, Caligula, was assassinated. Claudius faced assassination attempts. So Nero took over at a really critical and difficult time. These are only the big figures. We're in the position of a Roman audience. These statues come from all over Italy, now in different museums throughout Europe. But in Roman public buildings, you would have encountered the imperial family in similar ways. But I love one object here in the first section in particular, and it's an altar that at the bottom has a crowd scene. There you see the common people, the ones that don't usually make it into the visual record, in their short work tunics and with their families petitioning some official. The common people are what this exhibition is really all about. The emperors, by definition, were their champions, the champions of the plebs. And that led to conflict with the Senate or the senatorial elite as well. Now, Augustus didn't have a son of his own, which in the patriarchal Roman society was a problem. The succession, therefore, from Augustus went through the female line, his daughter Julia, his sister Octavia, and his wife Livia. So women of the ruling dynasty became extremely prominent and influential. And in the context of Roman society that was so patriarchal, that also led to conflict, as we will see later in the exhibition.
Just 2 months short of Nero's 17th birthday, he became emperor in AD 54. The transition was actually quite smooth, unlikely what happened with some of his predecessors. Claudius, the previous emperor, had long designed Nero as his heir. He adopted him, he granted him public honors, he even had him marry his daughter, Claudia Octavia. Nero could count on the support of the Senate and of the Praetorian Guard, an elite military unit stationed in Italy. Among his advisors were Afranius Burrus, the commander of said Praetorian Guard, as well as the famous philosopher Seneca, who used to be his tutor. Agrippina, his mother had gained incredible preeminence under Claudius and continued to play an important role at the beginning of Nero's reign as well. As we will see, things will soon change. From what survived of the literature of the time, the picture we get is quite a positive one. So it looks like the people had great expectation for this new young ruler and were expecting a new golden age. This portrait here was created exactly for Nero's ascension, and it represents him as a young ruler in his prime.
This is one of my favorite sections here in the exhibition, simply because of the range of material displayed. It's about war and diplomacy, aspects we don't often associate with Nero's reign. It's much more about Nero the artist in the common perception. But this was really crucial, and it takes us to different ends of the empire. It's the action takes place at the border to the Parthian Empire, Rome's great rival in the east, in Greater Iran, and in the northwest, Britain, where the Boudica rebellion is really the key element of Nero's reign. Some of the finds here come from rescue excavations in very recent years. So we have things found in Colchester in 2014. We have writing tablets found in the city of London in excavations between 2009 and 13. And the latest find in the exhibition is a letpick from Wales that was discovered only in 2019. So a great range of really different objects. Now, Nero inherited a lot of conflict from his predecessor Claudius, especially with the Parthians. It was a conflict about Armenia. Armenia, a buffer state in the Caucasus between the Roman Empire and the Parthian Empire. There was warfare, first victories, then setbacks, and finally a diplomatic solution, whereby Nero accepted a Parthian candidate for the Armenian throne, but crowned him officially in Rome. It was a huge PR triumph, and we'll pick up on that later in the exhibition. But the other great element is the Boudica rebellion. Britain had only been conquered 11 years before Nero became emperor under Claudius, partially conquered. The province was pretty wild still. There was a small part of the province in the southeast under just handed over to civilian administration, and then a military frontier with a resource-rich tribal belt beyond. It's really the greed of the Roman administration that caused much of the conflict and the actual Boudica rebellion afterwards. Britain wasn't settled yet. It wasn't quite as regulated. Even the sources tell us a lot about military contractors, soldiers, tax farmers exploiting the locals. And this really gives us important evidence that shows us the ugly side of Roman imperialism. It's a really important corrective to the other main official story. Behind me is really a stunning object. It's a set of slave chains, gang chains, from the National Museum of Wales in Cardiff. It was found, probably dedicated in antiquity, on Anglesey, which was an important center of the Druids in Britain. The context isn't quite clear, but that is revealing in its own right. It may have been used to chain up a gang of criminals or prisoners, slaves, even Roman prisoners of war. And the fact that we don't know tells us a lot about life in Britain at the time. Very fierce rebellion under Boudica. The nucleus of the Roman province was destroyed. The capital of Colchester, Londinium, Verulamium, all torched, burned to the ground. The rebels were eventually defeated, or freedom fighters, you might call them as well. Nero had to rebuild the province from the ground up. London, Roman Londinium, is essentially a Roman new foundation, and there are fantastic elements here. One of the icons of the British Museum collection is this bronze head of Nero here behind me. That was probably ripped off a statue in Colchester during the Boudica rebellion. The end of Nero's reign, he was en route to the east, to the Caucasus, to lead a military campaign there. It never happened, but it would have changed our perception of him considerably. One thing we have to do always is to reconstruct Nero's statues, and they tended to show him as a leading magistrate or a military commander-in-chief. So again, a very different picture of Nero that was put out during his lifetime.
here behind me, you can see a statue of a slave boy that comes from the Museo Nazionale Romano in Rome. This beautiful statue is a romanticized representation of slavery. The boy has fallen asleep while waiting for his master, who he will then accompany back home holding his lantern. Reality was, of course, very different, and Roman society was deeply divided and rife with social unrest. In AD 61, the prefect of the city of Rome was killed by one of his slaves. Despite the protest of the people, the Senate decided to uphold a pre-existing law according to which all enslaved members of household staff were supposed to be executed for the crime of just one of them. And despite the protest of the people, Nero decided to back the Senate decision. However, his building projects in Rome show that he had the needs of his people at heart. He built amenities for the welfare and the entertainment of the people of Rome. So most famously, a grand covered market where every sort of food could be found, and grandiose baths. And he always had very clear in mind that it was extremely important to ensure the food supply of the capital. And because of this, he improved the connection between Rome and Portus, an artificial harbour that was built by Claudius near Ostia. Together with this, he also built a wooden amphitheatre where gladiatorial games and hunts would take place. Games, or ludi in Latin, were extremely important in Roman culture. Gladiatorial combat, chariot racing, theatrical performances, they were all extremely popular. So popular, in fact, that complex stages were recreated to decorate the inside of Roman houses. We have an example behind me that was found in Pompeii and comes from the Archaeological Museum in Naples. The sort of events were highly politicized. So the city arrangement was based on the social standing of the members of the audience. The audience itself had a chance to appeal directly to the emperor if he was in attendance and vent their discontent. And the emperor could decide to show that he was siding with the Senate or with the plebs. Nero famously was the first emperor to appear on stage. This was described by ancient hostile sources as a scandalous and senseless act caused by Nero's misguided sense of his artistic skills. But if we consider all this, it becomes quite clear that Nero decided to take the stage in order to steer the political discourse.
In this section, we meet some of the women around Nero. Under the Julio-Claudians, the imperial wives and princesses became extremely important because the female bloodline ensured the succession. Looming behind me is a wonderful statue of Nero's mother, Agrippina. She was Augustus's great-granddaughter and the daughter of the hero Germanicus, who was Augustus's intended successor. Agrippina was very powerful, influential, very prominent in public life. Statues like this one, which shimmers like bronze, although it's carved from a rare exotic Egyptian hard stone, were set up all over Rome and the empire. And they really made clear to the public what an influential position she held in public life. She, like Nero, her son, provided a lifeline for Claudius in terms of stabilizing his own rule. Getting back as close as you could to Augustus, the founder of the dynasty, was crucial. And Agrippina was a key element in that. Roman girls were married, especially of that social class, aged 14, 15, half children still. And they were treated as such. So when these women became influential, that was resented by many in the elite. And the literary sources, almost without exception, vilify these women, accuse them of incest and adultery and so on, but most of these were trumped up politically motivated charges. Agrippina herself had been banished by her brother Caligula for a while and was then recalled under Claudius. Nero, and that's a key part of his legacy, killed, executed Agrippina, is accused of having murdered his first wife, possibly his second wife. These stories dominate his legacy and that notion of Nero as a deranged criminal mind. There's probably a lot more of political context behind all these, and there's again contrasting evidence. We can't excuse Nero for some of these accusations, but perhaps more interesting is the reaction of the Senate. For example, after Agrippina's death, they weren't outraged at all. They accorded Nero an immense array of public honors in Rome. They were jubilant that Agrippina, this powerful uberwoman, had finally been removed. Her statues were toppled, like so many others. And in this section, we'll see some other portraits, probably of Nero's wives. We can't always identify them with great certainty, because although they were so prominent, their memory was excised after Nero's death, and their statues, like Nero's own, were removed. There's one particularly touching sculpture here in this section, and that's a statue of a young girl, probably reflecting her premature death. And there are details of the iconography that may suggest that this could be an idealized portrait of Nero's young daughter who died only 3 months old. There's another very quirky object here in the section, and that's part of a kitchen wall from Pompeii, and it has graffiti incised in it. And these graffiti commemorate a visit by Nero and his second wife, Poppaea Sabina, who was popular in the Vesuvius region, to Pompeii. They dedicated jewelry in the Temple of Venus there. That gets me to an important element. The cities of Vesuvius were destroyed during the eruption of Vesuvius 11 years after Nero's death. And that means that there is a lot of evidence preserved there that we haven't got for other emperors. There are things like graffiti, inscriptions put out on the walls of houses and so on. They give us a very different ground up picture of Nero and his family. He was a lot more popular than the literary sources make us believe. And playing off these sources against each other and these different types of evidence helps to tell a much more rounded story.
To us, the defining moment of Nero's reign is the Great Fire of Rome. It started on the night of the 18th of July in AD 64, lasted for 9 days, and it destroyed 3 of the 14 districts in which the city of Rome was divided, and it heavily affected 7 more. Nero, despite the story, was not even in Rome where the fire started. It was actually in his coastal residence in Antium. He rushed to the city and he led the relief effort. After, he blamed and persecuted the Christians for the fire, which of course cemented his later negative reception. Once the fire was abated, Nero also led the rebuilding of the city, and by introducing new building regulation, he improved the living quarters in Rome. He also famously built a new grandiose palace, the Domus Aurea. The Domus Aurea, or the Golden House, was described by hostile sources as the epitome of decadent luxury and the house of a tyrant who expropriated both public and private land destroyed by the fire. It was indeed a grandiose palace, but it wasn't so far removed in terms of structure, appearance and furnishing from the big aristocratic villas that could be found in the countryside of the empire. You have an example behind me. It is a fresco coming from the Archaeological Museum in Naples. They give us an idea of what these aristocratic mansions built by the seaside or lakes could look like. So we must imagine Nero's Domus Aurea looking something like what you see behind me. However, Nero's palace was built on a grander scale than anything before, and instead of being on the countryside, it was actually built in the middle of the city of Rome, which broke with traditions. Nero's palace was supposed to act as the political backdrop for important public events, for the entertainment of the court and the senators, but part of it were very likely also for the enjoyment of the people. One such public event was the visit of the Persian royal delegation in Rome in AD 66. This was Nero's golden day when Tiridates was supposed to travel all the way to Rome to be crowned king of Armenia by Nero himself. This happened in the Forum at the presence of the people of Rome, and then celebration continued in the theater of Pompeii. Here behind me you have the gravestone of Alcimus, a stage worker in the theater of Pompeii, which might have been there and helped with the preparation of the theater. After Tiridates' coronation, Nero traveled to Greece. Ancient sources tell us that he only did so because he wanted to take part in all the games and festivals in the region. However, this was probably the first step of Nero's tour of the East. Unfortunately, Nero's plan changed. He had to rush back to Rome because of the rebellion in Judea and senatorial conspiracies.
In the end, Nero was abandoned by most of his followers and forced to commit suicide in a small villa outside Rome. He was only surrounded by his wet nurses and freedmen. And there, in the last section of the exhibition, there are some monuments that give us their names and details. There followed a year of savage civil war, the so-called Year of Four Emperors, when different usurpers fought it out throughout Italy. And we have some touching objects from these battlefields. The final object in the exhibition is right behind me. It's a portrait of Vespasian, the first emperor of the Flavian dynasty that followed Nero. And it's an interesting object because originally this was a portrait of Nero himself, and it was then changed, altered, recarved into a portrait of Vespasian. And that's what happened to most of Nero's legacy. His monuments disappeared, his name was erased from inscriptions, his portrait statues were dismantled, destroyed, reused. There's very little that survived this process of editing and destruction. But we know from the literary sources that there were various usurpers for many decades still that attracted a mass following and kept Nero's memory alive among the common people.
Thank you for joining us in this curator's tours of the Nero exhibition. We hope you enjoyed it and thank you for your support.
Il Museo Nazionale Romano è lieto, molto lieto di partecipare alla grande mostra organizzata dal British Museum, Nerone, l'uomo dietro al mito. È una grande sfida per il British Museum aver proposto questa mostra perché Nerone è una delle figure più complesse dell'antichità. Si conosce il Nerone, il mostro, insomma, che secondo la leggenda cantava davanti alla città che bruciava, che aveva ucciso la madre e le due mogli. Ma ovviamente questo è anche il mito di Nerone. Nerone è una personalità storica importante e si sa dagli autori antichi più autorevoli come Tacito che Nerone, tra l'altro, durante l'incendio di Roma, non era neanche a Roma, era nella sua villa di Anzio. E qua, tra l'altro, abbiamo delle opere che provengono da questa villa imperiale eccezionale, e opere molto belle come la fanciulla che si trova dietro di me. Al Museo Nazionale Romano Nerone è presente un po' dappertutto, presente qua in questa sala dei capolavori della scultura, perché ci sono appunto diversi capolavori che provengono dalla sua villa imperiale ad Anzio e pure a Subiaco, come la fanciulla d'Anzio, il fanciullo di Subiaco, ma si trova anche alle terme di Diocleziano, nell'aula più importante aperta in questo momento, che è l'aula undicesima, dove c'è un grande mosaico che proviene dalla stessa villa imperiale di Anzio. E soprattutto, direi storicamente, forse il documento più importante è presente negli atti degli Arvali, nel chiostro piccolo delle terme di Diocleziano, dove diverse iscrizioni, che tra l'altro sono ad anni consecutivi, riguardano il regno di Nerone e le vicende di questo regno importante. E quindi per noi è un privilegio partecipare con dei prestiti eccezionali, ma anche con una partecipazione ad altre attività del British Museum, attività in remoto, come si fa adesso dalla crisi, dalla pandemia, ma è anche un bene per quanto ci riguarda, perché abbiamo potuto stringere un vero partnership con il British Museum e quindi cominceremo questa collaborazione particolare, privilegiata, con delle attività online sui nostri social e sul sito del Museo Nazionale Romano. E quindi non vedo l'ora, per quanto mi riguarda, di visitare questa mostra e capire come i nostri colleghi del British intendono chiarire tutta questa situazione storica veramente importante e complicata del regno di Nerone. E quindi do la parola ai colleghi del British Museum.
Good evening, everybody. What a total pleasure it is to see you tonight. Many, many old friends and many new. We have close on 2,000 people with us so far this evening from over 40 countries. So what a delight that even through the terrible events of this year, people are still fascinated by history and need to learn more and understand more. I'm going to talk very briefly. I'm Bethany Hughes, a great supporter of all explorations into the ancient world. But tonight our star turns are the curators of the exhibition, Torsten Opper and Francesca Bologna. Now, Torsten and Francesca are going to give you a very brief summary. It's been described as a narrative overview or a whistle-stop tour of the exhibition and of Nero's reign. There is going to be plenty of time to ask questions, and in fact, even before we went live tonight, the questions were coming into the chat box. So I think we're going to have a Socratic dialogue at the end of the presentation and share ideas together. So I would just like to welcome, Torsten is going to start us off. So Torsten and Francesca, the curators of the exhibition, please share what you'd like, just as your brief summary of this extraordinary man. This man who's commanded such extraordinary history and has also generated such remarkable myths and legends. Over to you, Torsten.
Thank you so much, Bethany, and a very warm welcome to all of you. Before I start, let me just take this opportunity to thank our colleagues in Rome and indeed throughout the UK and Europe. As you all experienced it, this was a difficult year, and without our collaboration and these loans, the exhibition couldn't have happened. I hope our colleagues feel we've done them justice and their great objects justice. About two-thirds of the 220 or so objects are loans. Great things, many not seen in the UK before. If we could have the first slide, please. So Nero is one of the most famous Roman emperors, and he's the most infamous. If you like alliterations, he is a matricide, he's a megalomaniac, he's a monster, he's the archetypal tyrant. A gluttonous, profligate, deluded artist, what have you. Now all these stereotypes that we're probably all familiar with, and you see them here on the slide, a film still from 1951 from Covardis, they're all based on a very narrow range of literary sources, written by members of the Roman elite, mostly senatorial in background. So that's all we have. People like Tacitus, Suetonius, Cassius Dio, they give us this narrative backdrop. And that really has shaped
Nero's legacy for 2 millennia now. It's rarely been challenged. It's a massive legacy. His sources, however, also give us hints of a different tradition. We know that after Nero's death, even though allegedly he was such a crazy person, he was hated, the plebs, the common people in Rome, deposited flowers on his tomb. We know that over the next 2 or 3 decades, especially in the Greek East, there were imposters, people who pretended to be Nero and gathered mass followings. So there's a weird contrast between the things we're told. Hated by the elite, apparently quite loved and popular with the common people. That's something we want to explore in the exhibition. It's not about rehabilitating Nero, but seeing why we're told certain things about him and not others. There's the film still with Peter Ustinov, literally on the roof of his palace, as the saying goes, fiddling while Rome burns, so playing the lyre. Among the many things, barely a crime he hasn't been accused of, Nero. Killed his mother, with whom he's allegedly had an incestuous relationship, killed his first 2 wives, burned down Rome on purpose to build this magnificent palace, and a weird, deranged performer. The object on the left really encapsulates that. It was very famous from the 17th century on, when it's first documented, and is now linked to Nero's Wikipedia entry. So again, if you Google Nero, that's the image you'll see. And you can recognize that only a small part of the face is ancient. You see it in a sort of dark honey color there, the forehead and eyes. That was a portrait of Nero recarved later. Everything else is a restoration. Brilliant technically, and well informed by the antiquarian sources. So it's really a 3D expression of what we can find in the ancient literary record. He's a sneering tyrant. He looks fat and evil and mean. And as we could, in a way, deconstruct this particular sculpture, so we can explore and deconstruct the myth of Nero. If you want a quick soundbite, it's 2,000 years of lies and manipulations, potentially politically motivated, a distorted view of Nero that we can balance in the exhibition with other objects that give us a contrasting point of view. So if you have the next slide, please. So you just saw Nero the monster in this later caricature version. The first object in the exhibition is this statue of Nero as a boy, and we can date it quite precisely. It's now in the Louvre, comes from Rome or near Rome. It shows Nero as a 12 or 13 year old. His mother Agrippina had just married the reigning emperor Claudius in AD 49. A year later, Nero was adopted by Claudius as crown prince. He was born Lucius Domitius Ahenobarbus into a family closely related to the ruling Julio-Claudians. So here is this little innocent looking boy. 4 years later, he was ruler of the Roman world. And age 30, he was dead. So there's a lot in a short life. The statue is really fascinating. It's one of the very few images of Nero that have survived. He looks quite innocent. Our idea behind the exhibition was to start at the beginning, as it were, leave the legacy aside, and follow Nero through his life in real time, in inverted commas. Things could have developed differently. Nothing was predetermined. And I think that's what we want to do. There's also the map of the Roman Empire, and you see this huge, vast extent. It had grown through military expansion over the preceding centuries. There was a savage civil war at the end of the Republic, and then Augustus, the first emperor, came to power, and there was a period of peace. And that brought prosperity, economic growth, and social mobility for many. There were many people from the leading people from the provinces who wanted to have a say in the Senate in Rome. There were former slaves who became extremely wealthy. So a social dynamic, there's a lot of social aspiration, but that leads to conflict as well. Social, it's a zero sums game in the minds of the elite. Social aspiration of the masses leads to status anxiety among the elite. And that is the background music to Nero's reign, if you like. There's also on the map the Parthian Empire. Conflict and then collaborations with the Parthians, the big rival power that dominate much of Nero's reign. So you have the contrasting things. You have the Parthians, big geopolitics, and up in the northwest, you have Britain with the Boudicca rebellion. That gives us a nice detailed picture of the reality of Roman imperialism. Next slide, please. So Nero and the family of Augustus. Nero was the great-great-grandson of Augustus, the first princeps. And, you know, we call him emperor, which is, you know, a complicated term, maybe not quite accurate. Technically, he's the first man, first among equals. A winner of the civil war, he establishes a new form of government, the principate. And he declares that essentially a restoration of the old republic. But in reality, it's a monarchy in disguise. That means all the senators are still there and they hold their offices and so on. But the court becomes increasingly important. But the court, the officials are different. They're often members of the imperial household, former slaves and so on. So there's a lot of tension there. And the principate is a constantly evolving improvisation. So there are no clear rules for the succession. Every transition of power between members of the Julio-Claudian family, so the family of Augustus, is troubled. When Augustus dies, aged 76, his stepson Tiberius takes over, who spends then the last 10 years of his reign almost in self-imposed exile on Capri because he's fed up with the Senate. His successor, Caligula, is assassinated, and Claudius comes into power, and there's constant conflict with the Senate as well there. So we mustn't look at Nero in isolation. What happens to Nero has happened to many of his predecessors. For these early principes, the relationship with the Senate is really crucial. Another key aspect is that Augustus didn't have a son of his own. And in the patriarchal society of the Roman world, that is difficult. The line of succession, the bloodline of the imperial family, goes to his daughter Julia, his sister Octavia, and his third wife Livia, who's there next to him. And this is, as you probably gathered, is an installation shot from the exhibition. That means that these Julio-Claudian women are really very important. They're very prominent in public life. They have great influence, and that's resented also in Roman society, particularly by the elite. So there are lots of ingrained conflicts there already, and they come to the fore during Nero's reign. Next slide, please. The transition from Claudius to Nero was extremely well managed. Nero was really built up for many years as a crown prince. He was extremely well tutored. He was given moments in the limelight. He gave games, he gave speeches in the Senate. He was preferred over Claudius's own natural son, Britannicus, who was 2-3 years younger, probably too young, really, to be considered a potential successor. When Claudius died, everything went very smoothly. You see here on the right a relief that shows members of the Praetorian Guard, and they were ready and on site, and a speech had been prepared, and this was really a very welcome new reign. Here was a descendant of Augustus, young, vigorous, a huge contrast to Claudius, good-looking by the standards of the time. Here's the same portrait we used for the poster. This is the same type you saw earlier as a boy, but more mature. And he's slightly turned, really a lot of dynamism. He's supposed to be the new Augustus. In poetry, what we have left of it, he's compared to Apollo. Nero apparently was also some shade of blonde, so like Apollo. He's also compared to Mars, the god of war. It's a very different notion of this ruler we get. So young, vigorous, this is the beginning of a new golden age. The Praetorians are there in the background, and just by the way, another relief from the Louvre, that comes from the triumphal arch in Rome erected for Claudius' conquest of Britain 11 years earlier. If we move on. Agrippina, Nero's mother, was extremely important for the transition. She'd become very prominent under Claudius already. He probably married her to shore up his own position. She was Augustus's great-granddaughter, after all, and the daughter of Germanicus, one of the great heroes and intended successors. And there's this fantastic statue from Rome, from the Capitolini, looks like bronze, but is carved from an exotic Egyptian heartstone. So an amazing artwork in its own right. And the exhibition is full of these as well. And a fantastic series of coins that talks about Agrippina's status. She was almost a co-ruler, almost a regent for Nero. The first on the left is the back and front of a silver coin struck under Claudius still. And quite remarkably, Agrippina's portrait is on the front. She's very prominent. That tells us a lot about her status. And Nero, her son, the grand prince, is on the back. Then the aureus, the gold coin on the top right, is just after Nero had taken over. But Agrippina is there with him on front, and her titles, not Nero's, are there. Nero's are on the back. So that tells you something about her status. And then the next one, they're side by side, and Nero's titles are there. And a few months later, Agrippina slowly disappears and is not on the coinage anymore. And that tells us about the conflicts at court and how she's slowly relegated to the sidelines. Next slide, please. The next big section in the exhibition we've called War and Diplomacy. And it's not something you'd normally associate with Nero and his reign. You know, you expect something about him as an artist and performer. But war and diplomacy really is crucial throughout his reign. He inherited big conflicts from his predecessor. There was a conflict with the Parthians, that big rival power, in any sense, Rome's equal, in some ways even superior in the east, greater Iran. And there was the Boudica rebellion in Britain. We mentioned it already. Britain only conquered 11 years before. And there are these great objects here on the right, one of the icons of the British Museum collection. It's a bronze head of Nero, still sometimes called Claudius. It's Nero. That was probably ripped off a statue in Colchester, the Roman capital at the time, during the Boudica rebellion. Britain really gives us a local ground-up picture of what happens, what the reality of Roman imperialism really means. The core part of the province had only just been handed over to civilian administration. All around was the military frontier and then a resource-rich tribal belt. And there was still warfare. There was an ambitious governor eager for glory and booty who wanted to extend the province outwards. And the locals were treated with great disrespect. It was a province swarming with soldiers, with military contractors, with tax farmers, and so on. So no wonder that it came to a rebellion. Rebels or freedom fighters, whatever you want to call them. It's an interesting little statuette, and I remember that comes from Venice. I remember us holding it there in our hands and have a photo of Francesca cradling it fondly. It's now in the exhibition. That's so important because it gives us a full-length Nero. So, you know, probably our bronze head would have looked like that on a complete statue. And he's in military armor. So the Nero of Nero's day was the chief magistrate in the toga, or the commanding general in military gear. He wasn't the lyre player or artist at all. So we have to reconstruct that. Next slide, please. And this is just to give you a flavor of what we have in the exhibition. There's an awful lot of new research, and there are fantastic new finds as well that we can show in the exhibition for the first time in context. One object I find incredibly powerful is this gang chain on the left, which comes from Anglesey. Was used to chain together five prisoners, captives, maybe even Roman prisoners of war. Tells us a lot about the reality of life in the province. On the top, you have the so-called Fenwick Halter that was found during rescue excavations in Colchester in 2014. It's probably the personal jewelry and belongings of a Roman veteran settler couple. They buried it in haste as the rebels approached, or the Iceni under Boudica approached, and they didn't live to retrieve these treasures. On the bottom, we have so-called Bloomberg tablets. They're writing tablets discovered between 2009 and 13 in the city of London. The earliest documents of Latin, the earliest evidence of Latin handwriting in Britain. And they are of the Neronian period. And they talk about the prosperity of London before the rebellion and the quick rebuilding of London, which, like Colchester and Verulamium, had been completely destroyed. Nero considered giving up the province. He decided against, but rebuilt it. He recalled that ambitious governor and replaced some of the top officials. There's a lot about the right form of government. So the new people who come in are of provincial background, and they're probably more lenient. That's quite significant. These are all things hated by the traditional elite. We know, and I'll come to an end very quickly, you know, there were many impeachment trials at the same period, corrupt governors being put on trial in front of the Senate in Rome. For Britain, that probably wasn't the right moment, but it gives you some context of the Neronian period and the politics behind this all. The next slide, and I think that will be my final slide, is about war with the Parthians. So that was conflict over the buffer state of Armenia in the Caucasus. There were initial successes, a Roman army went there, conquered the Armenian capital, then setbacks. There's an evocation of this triumphal arch, which you also see on the coin there, and we have some original fragments in the exhibition, and the coin portrait of the Parthian great king, Vologases. That's Nero's opposite number. And the amazing thing that happens is that they, by necessity in a way, but they agree ultimately a diplomatic solution whereby Nero accepts a Parthian prince as the new Armenian king. But the deal is that this Parthian prince will come to Rome and will be crowned by Nero in Rome. So for Nero, this is a tremendous PR success. And you know, from some of the finds from the eastern provinces, this was of huge significance throughout the empire. So Nero had this image as a good military leader and successful diplomat. And that contrasts with what we think about him as well. And at this stage, I'll hand over to Francesca, who continues the narrative run through.
Thank you, Thorsten. And thank you for the next slide. And so we now move from a conflict at the borders of the empire, so to inner conflicts within Roman society in a way. So this statue here comes from Rome, and it represents a lanternario, so a slave boy whose job was to light the way for his master holding his lantern. And here the boy has fallen asleep while waiting dutifully for his master. And this is a extremely beautiful piece coming from Rome, but it is a very unrealistic representation of what slavery was actually like. And the reality of slavery was extremely different, and Roman society was deeply divided. And there is a anecdote that we have from Nero's reign that is quite telling. And around the time of Boudica's revolt in AD 61 in Rome, the prefect of the city was killed by one of his slaves. The Senate on this occasion decided to uphold a existing law according to which all enslaved members of the household were to be executed for the crime of but one of them. The people protested, and however, in this specific occasion, Nero decided to back the Senate. Although it is important to notice that when the Senate actually started thinking about further punishment, which would also hit the freed member of the household, Nero vetoed this further cruelty. And if we move to the next slide, and so as we said, on this occasion, Nero decided to side with the Senate. However, we do have proof that of his concern, of his deep concern for the well-being of the people, especially those of Rome. If we do turn to the building projects he completed in Rome, we do see that he built, as was expected of emperors at the time, really, but he did so with great enthusiasm, if we can use this word. He did build amenities for the welfare and entertainment of the people. Unfortunately, these buildings are now lost to us, but we do have accounts and description of them, and in some cases, as you can see here, we have them depicted on coins of great quality. So here, Nero was very aware of how important it was to maintain the food supply of the capital. And here you can see on the left, the Arbor of Ostia, which had been completed, of Portus near Ostia, which had been completed by Clodius. What Nero did was to improve the connection between this harbor and the capital, and Associated with this, he also built a grand covert market, the Macellum Magnum, which you can see represented on the coin on the right instead. On top of these, we also know that he built grandiose baths and a wooden amphitheater when gladiatorial fights and hunts could be organized for the entertainment of the people. And if you please go to the next slide. So, entertainment, games, or ludi in Latin, were extremely important for Roman society. So political leaders could gain incredible popular support by organizing these games. And during the Republic, the aristocrats competing among each other to organize such games. But with this new political system, it became the prerogative of the emperor to organize them. And this was not just about entertainment. These events were highly politicized. So the sitting arrangement was based on social order, the performances, because we're not just talking about, as you can see here, gladiatorial games and chariot racing, there were also theatrical performances. So these performances sometimes hinted, not necessarily too subtly, at ongoing political events. And the audience could appeal directly to the emperor if he was in attendance, and so on. So we already get quite a interesting picture. If you turn to the next slide, please. So Nero famously was the first emperor to perform on stage. This is described as something absolutely scandalous, caused it only by Nero's own vanity. He's just described as a narcissistic, deluded artist. However, if we consider what I just said, there are two elements that we should consider when assessing and trying to understand why Nero decided to appear on stage. And one element is political, and the other is more cultural. So as I said before, these events, these games, these performances were highly politicized. So by appearing on stage, Nero could actually steer the political discourse, he could steer the reaction of the audience, and he did so thanks to the Augustiani, so a professional claque that would be among the audience when he performed. And this is the political aspect. The cultural aspect is that actually the fact that Nero decided to appear on stage was part of a bigger cultural shift. It was not the first one, actually. Well before Nero, men and women of the elite performed on stage or fought in the arena as gladiators. So this was harshly criticized by traditionalists, but again, what Nero does is just part of this cultural shift that was happening at the time and had been happening for quite a while. And the coin you see on the right here is quite telling because it represents Apollo. It's a coin minted under Nero, represents the god Apollo. And however, according to Suetonius, this is not Apollo, but Nero depicting himself as Apollo, which is not the case, as you can see in the exhibition, as we have the image magnified. But we decided to put it here because this is quite telling of how sometimes it's not about what things really are, but about how they looked. And so this is a good example of how images and history and stories can be manipulated in order to change perception. If you go to the next slide, please. And this section, Passion and Discord of the exhibition, is essentially about the women in Nero's life. And we decided to put them all together in one section because actually how Nero's interaction with these women are described in ancient sources is quite telling about history can be fabricated and manipulated. So starting from the top, most famously, Nero killed his mother Agrippina. So we're not here to say it was innocent. This is not the point. But if you do read the accounts, you do realize about her death, you do realize they are quite far-fetched. They involve a collapsible boat and every possible the device of an odd story. And not only they are far-fetched, but if you read them carefully, you can see how they borrow quite heavily from drama. So you literally see how lines from tragedies became lines on history books, basically. And if you then move to Claudia Octavia, of which you can see a possible portrait on the left of the slide. So Claudia Octavia was Nero's first wife. And again, the story about her death is just too perfect. So Claudia Octavia is the perfect, dutiful wife. Poppaea is the devious mistress. And Nero is just a puppet in her hand. He convinced him to banish and then have Octavia executed. The story is just so perfect that it's basically a cliche. So it makes you wonder, can we really just believe it? And lastly, Poppaea, which we have on the right, sources tell us that Nero loved her. However, he kicked her to death when she was pregnant. And again, even here, it is a motive of the crazy monarch kicking his wife to death. It's actually something that appears over and over again in literature. So something that we should challenge when we see it connected with Nero. If we now go to the next slide, please. And so the fire, the great fire of Rome, this is to us what defines Nero's reign and legacy to this day. So this great fire of Rome started by the Circus Maximus on the night of the 15th of July, 64, lasted no less than 9 days and essentially destroyed the city of Rome. Nero was not even in Rome at the time. He was in Antium, so about 50 kilometers away from Rome. And however, he rushed back to the capital and led the relief efforts. And however, when the fire abated, he blamed and persecuted the Christians for it, which very likely played an important role in how his image was later very negatively depicted. And Nero rebuilt the city, introduced new building regulation, which improved the living quarters, and however, most famously, built himself an amazing new palace, the Domus Aurea, which we can see in the next slide. And so the Domus Aurea, the Golden House, this palace was described by ancient hostile sources as the palace of the residence of a tyrant, the epitome of decadent luxury, and authors like Pliny and Martial said how the palace encircled the whole capital. And indeed, this was a great palace, which buildings spread on both the Palatine Hill and the Esquiline Hill, connected by porticos and Colonnade Square. It even had a vast artificial pool. It was decorated with incredible marbles and fresco. However, it is important to note that despite, I mean, of course, this palace was a great backdrop for Nero's public events and for the entertainment he offered to the court and the senators. However, part of this palace were very likely accessible to the people. So this was not just a private residence that encompassed the whole of the city as it has been described. Now, go to the next slide. So, as Tulsa said at the beginning, this was a period of great prosperity and great wealth, which in turn led to conspicuous and competitive consumption amongst the members of the elite. So this became a marker of social status. So here you see some example of luxury. So from a fresco showing elite villa architecture, which, by the way, these aristocratic villas were not so far removed from what the Domus Aurea, Nero's palace, must have looked like. They were just built on a different scale. So fresco showing a villa by the seaside, In the lower left, you see a famous marine cup. So this Vasa Murina, of which we read in the sources, were extremely costly vessel made of precious stone that came from the east. And on the lower right, instead, you see some silverware that was found near Pompeii. However, quite interestingly, this silverware did not actually, from the context, we know that it did not belong to a member of the aristocracy, but it belonged to wealthy freedmen that were active in the area. And this is evidence of how this luxurious lifestyle started spreading to the newly rich, which in turn caused social anxiety among the members of the elite. If we now turn to the next slide. So we know we have this idea of Nero as a hated tyrant. That's the picture we got from the sources. However, we do have archaeological evidence of how popular it must have been among the people. So here you see some graffiti coming. The doodle you can see on the left comes from Rome. It's a doodle of Nero coming from the Palatine. On the right, you have instead graffiti from Pompeii. One is a graffito naming Nero and his wife Poppaea. The second one is a poem that tells us about the offerings that Nero and Poppaea made to the temple of Venus in Pompeii. So these evidence, together with other things you will see in the exhibition, prove that Nero was actually popular. So they tell us the other side of the story. They show us the voices of the Roman people. And we've now turned to the last slide. Well, Nero's story comes to a almost abrupt end. So after the, throughout his reign, he had to deal with a number of conspiracies. Just like any other emperor, really, Nero was not special from this point of view. The turning point is the Pisonian conspiracy of AD 65. The plot is discovered. The conspirators are executed or forced to commit suicide, and famously among them are the philosopher Seneca, as well as the famous writer Petronius. And Nero lived for a tour of Greece, possibly the first step of his campaign in the East, but is forced to rush back to Rome due to a rebellion of the governor of Gaul, Vindex, and then of Galba, at the time the governor of Spain. It is at this point that the Senate declares Nero the enemy of the state, and he first tries to flee from Rome, but then is essentially forced to commit suicide on the 9th of June, AD 68. And after his death, we have a 18 month of civil war, the so-called year of the four emperors, and at last, we have a new dynasty coming to power, the Flavians, starting with Vespasian, a former general of Nero. And that is the end of our story.
Francesca, thank you so much. And Torsten, how rich and how brilliant to see these myths and legends not always being punctured, but being mollified and nuanced. And the questions are coming in thick and fast. I've just got one for you before we get the questions from the public. This is a very eagerly awaited and long awaited exhibition, actually only 6 months late, which is pretty spectacular given what we've all been through. Why for you was it the right time to mount this exhibition? Was it because of the availability of some of this extraordinary new archaeology, like the Fennec Hoard, for instance, or was it just because it felt like it was the right time to reevaluate the man? So was it led by objects and archaeology, or by history?
I mean, I would say both. Torsten, do you want to start, or? Thorsten, I think you're muting, so I'm going to start then. So Torsten unmute himself. So I would say both, because of course, this is an exhibition that would have been completely different 20 or 30 years ago. There have been some excellent new discoveries in this country, and that's why the section about Roman Britain is actually one of our favorites in this exhibition. Mm-hmm. And not just in the UK, even in Rome, there have been new excavations that allow us to understand better, for example, the spread of the fire of Rome and so on. So there is new discovery. There are new discoveries, but also, what comes from the story of Nero is mostly about how we should approach historical accounts, but more widely we could see information, and that is I feel quite relevant always, but of course at times like these it has become possibly even more relevant than at other times, and this is also, which is stunning, the first exhibition on Nero in the UK, and considering the connection, the local connection, the Boudica revolt and so on, this is just, it's incredible. So it was a good time, I would say.
Mm. It is remarkable that, isn't it? And thinking about Boudica, as you say, she holds kind of such an important place in the British psyche. There are lots of myths and legends about her as well. What do you both think Nero thought of the Boudiccan event and what was going on in Britain? You know, were we just kind of right at the edges and the kind of fringes of his consciousness, or do you think that there was an opinion that he held?
That's a super interesting question. We don't know, I mean, because the historic Boudicca and the Boudicca we get in the literary sources are obviously completely different. Tacitus and others create this antitype to the Roman elite whip, but again, here's a very manly, you know, and that's a negative stereotype, obviously, in the Roman psyche. Leader, but very energetic, and she, you know, she's the antagonist or the equivalent to Agrippina, for example. I think Nero was mostly devastated and disappointed with his officials. I mean, it's this, you know, there's a lot of conflict. Senators and senatorial commanders didn't have the possibilities open to them in the Republic anymore. Fewer opportunities for conflict. And Britain was one of the few provinces where that could be done, and they went over the top. And it was really devastating. I mean, the losses were enormous, and I think it took Nero a long time to make up for that. And there are many reforms, whether it was Nero himself, or he had a good hand in choosing clever advisors, there are currency reforms, there are tax. They're really kept to hold officials accountable and so on. So I think a lot of the focus of his paper was on these aspects.
Mm-hmm. Fascinating. And actually there was an early question from Lynn Jensen who was asking about his advisors. Do we know if there was one particular person upon whom he depended? And if so, what was their political agenda? So how driven do you think Nero was by the men around him?
Women.
And women.
Well, we know from at the beginning, especially Agrippina played, I mean, at least sources tell us that she played a very important role. I think maybe it doesn't want then get into far too detail, but I think something we need to state quite clearly from the start is that these are absolutely tremendously interesting answer for which we might never, a question for which we might never have an answer, because really what we have, which is our issue with Nero, but not only Nero, is that we have only sources that are presenting a very specific angle. So it sometimes is quite different to understand the motives of the people whose lives we read about. For example, we have, let's take Seneca. Seneca was Nero's tutor and he became one of his advisors. And we have historians writing about him that very clearly use sources that were sometimes in favor of Seneca and sometimes against Seneca. So we have some picture of Seneca as this Stoic philosopher that was just trying to basically guide Nero in the best possible way. And then we have other sources that present him in quite a different way. And we can see how the histories that survive sometimes speak one side and sometimes the other. For example, Nero was a Stoic, yes, and we do know that one of the possible causes of Boudicca's revolt were the fact that Seneca, among others, had withdrew quite suddenly some big loans that he did to members of the local elite, So that's not really sort of Stoic philosopher you would imagine. Thorsten, if you want to...
No, that's exactly it. Seneca is one of the big names. There's Burrus, his partner in crime, if you like, or in leadership, the commander of the Praetorian Guard. And there is a hint in the sources that there was conflict. There's different traditions. There was definitely a tradition that blamed Seneca for lots of the bad things. He was Nero's tutor, became his chief advisor and minister, and became enormously wealthy. It's quite quirky. We have a cast of his only surviving portrait from antiquity in the exhibition that was found in 1812 or thereabouts. And for centuries, a very different portrait type had been identified as Seneca, because he's this stoic saint, and it gets us to the motivation behind the conspirators and so on. There's an emaciated, philosophical-looking man. And then popped out this name portrait. It was a rather well-fed person who clearly enjoyed the luxuries of life. So as Seneca became sanctified, Nero became vilified. There's opposing poles, and the tradition then gets streamlined, where Nero is just evil and Seneca is the antipode.
And lots of people saying how fascinating they're finding it, that he was genuinely popular. Andrew Vincenti is asking, though, in terms of graffiti or graffito, is there just one that survives that says he's marvellous, or actually are there quite a few graffiti praising Nero?
I mean, from recent research, it appears that his name is the one that appears the most often in Pompeii. Let's keep in mind that Pompeii was actually destroyed by the eruption of Mount Vesuvius about 11 years after Nero's death. So we have all the Julio Claudius before Nero, then we have Nero, then we have the first Flavians, and still, what we would expect, if he was such a master, the name of Vespasian or Titus would be the most common in Pompeii, but actually it's Nero, which is quite telling. It's just his name, and often with Pompeius everywhere, some of them clearly praising him, and I think possibly the poem that we had in one of the slides is the most interesting and telling, but really we got many graffiti from Pompeii that hail Nero.
And he was, of course, famous in Pompeii for helping to re-establish the games after they'd been cancelled.
It might seem so. Probably the best connection was through Popea, because Popea's family had properties in the area, so that would, of course, and his name often appears next to her. So I feel like since it's a bit contested whether or not it stopped the ban on the games, I feel definitely the Popea link was very strongly felt by people in Pompeii and in the Vesuvian area.
A number of people are asking, he does seem to have, to put it politely, a conflicted relationship with women, as far as we can tell from the historical sources. Be really interested to hear from you both. It's very difficult, obviously, to get into the minds of the ancients and to understand them psychologically. But if we were to try to, and, you know, for you two, you've immersed yourself in Nero's life. Francesca and Thorsten, what do you think Nero's relationship was with women? This is a question that's coming in from all corners of the world.
It's a good question too. I mean, Nero's legacy is a lot about his relationship with the women around him. And you could psychologize this. I mean, his own mother, Agrippina, was sent into exile when he was about a year or a year and a half old. So, you know, he grew up without her for a period. His father died when he was three. So there's perhaps some sort of estrangement there. But then again, I think it's probably more interesting that that's quite typical for the Roman elite. One of the touching objects in the exhibition is the tombstone of Nero's wet nurse, Claudia Ecloge. And we know from the reports of his death that he was then buried by his first love, a freed woman, Claudia Acte, and his two wet nurses. So there's that. But there's a lot of evidence that he was really in love with his second wife, Poppaea. The key thing for Nero is that the surviving literary accounts are uniformly biased against him. They follow rhetorical patterns, and they're from A to Z, they're negative. They're black and white. There's no objective layer with a few rhetorical flourishes on top. They're trying to assassinate Nero's character, and his relationship with his women is part of that. The women are not liked either, as we said at the outset, because they're so prominent during the Julio-Claudian period. most of these authors in modern terms are misogynistic. I mean, really no doubt about that. All the wives and the princesses, they're adulteresses, they're incestuous and so on. And these are all just political slogans. That's to take them down a peg, really.
What do you think, Francesco, if you can try to find your way, fight your way through these misogynist sources, what's your...
Yeah, I feel like we really, when we are trying to, we have a problem with trying to find the hidden Nero, if you wanna use them, and we have an even bigger problem trying to find out about his relationship with women, because we basically meet a double bias. We have the bias against women that we do see in historical sources, and then we have the bias against Nero. So it's a double bias that makes it, I feel, almost impossible to find out what's the reality of it.
Yeah, and if I just may, one thing, I think throughout the exhibition, the exciting thing, or I think the important thing is to get away from Nero the person in that sense as an exception and look at the underlying patterns of Roman society and how much what Nero does or doesn't do is part of a wider trend. I think we can use Nero as a way into that and really look at the tensions and conflicts within society and the prejudices and the gender relationships and so on.
One of the first questions that came in was a question about the Republic, that do either of you think after his death there was a chance that the Republic could be re-established in Rome, or is that extremely unlikely?
That was the rhetoric, I'm sure Francesca
agrees. The moment
agrees.
Was gone.
There were moments, I mean, the senatorial class had made its peace with the principate because that kept the peace. They knew one person probably should be in charge. They didn't want, so monarchy is okay in some form, but not hereditary. You know, we always use this analogy, the cardinals in the Catholic Church. Every cardinal in theory could be pope. So every senator probably thought, in an ideal world, you know, he could become emperor. And just after the assassination of Caligula, they had a debate in the Senate. Various candidates among the senators came to the fore, and, you know, they were even trying to start an election. But by that time, Claudius had bribed the Praetorians, and they put him on the throne, and that was the end of the matter. And that is a repeated pattern, really.
Gavin Ramsden asked again early about the court and the legal system, and he said very, really interesting what you were saying. How regular were freemen appeals in the court, and sort of could you just paint a picture of those? I mean, what did those courtrooms look like?
During the impeachment trials in particular,
I think just generally, yes, I think impeachment trials, but also regular appeals from freemen. But the impeachment trials, that's great, because you've been talking about those.
I mean, these in particular peaked under Nero, their studies. The quantity increases during Nero's reign. So that says something about trying to reform certain things. I mean, you know, the empire isn't that old, or the principate as an institution is 80 years old. So there's a lot of stuff that needs to be sorted out and fall into place. And Nero is a member of a new generation. He's already grown up with some of these changes, absorbed them. But it's an empire of, I don't know, at that time, 40, 50, maybe 60 million people. The elite, the senators, are 600 of the old nobility with very old-fashioned traditional views, and there's tension in there. The emperor is personally hugely involved in the legal system, of course.
Again, a lot of people are asking, there's an anonymous question from Brazil. Why is it that we love to use Nero to measure up to our contemporary politicians? So there've been comparisons with Bolsonaro, with Trump, with our own Boris. A question to both of you on the panel. Do you think this is valid? And are there any comparisons between these big characters of contemporary politics and the ancient character of Nero? Francesca?
I mean, I'm always a bit worried about making this comparison. I feel like the reason why with Nero and historical characters like him is so easy is that they have reached the point where they're not even people anymore. They're just ideas of, in this case, the mad tyrant or the incompetent politician, which is completely taken by some other pointless pursuit. I think the reason why the shoes fit and it's just so wide, basically, that it can be used and reused. And Yeah, I always wonder why Nero became so popular. I got the feeling, talking with some friends as well, that might be something that has to do with the English-speaking world rather than any other country. That might be my bias. So I don't know, Torsten, if what you think.
Well, we have the fiddling Balrog Burns is a classic. I mean, that's a metaphor used all the time. I think Francesca is right. Nero is this larger, but it's only the Nero in the sources, okay? It's not probably the real historic Nero, but the Nero we've come to believe in is larger than life. He's vain, he's arrogant and what. So everything we hate in our politicians, we can project onto him. But, you know, it's an artificial Nero.
A very interesting question from Iran Barry, who says, is Nero getting up on stage the equivalent of politicians today reaching out directly to their followers on Twitter? What do you think?
I like the comparison, really. Yes, yeah. I even be a social media guy these days. Yes, I can see him. Yes.
Yeah, I would say as well. I mean, reaching out to the public directly in the theatre or in the circus is exactly the equivalent to that. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And we talk rather blithely about his death and the fact that it was a suicide, and it's just one of those things that gets sort of slightly trotted out, you know, on the pages of history. Question to both of you, what significance was that? I mean, is it something which is considered a weak way to die, or is there a sense of it, you're taking control of your death and it's a beautiful death? Maybe Thorsten first and then Francesca.
It's a really good point. I mean, it was an honourable death. That's what you're supposed to do. Roman society, especially for the elite, is all about dignity and maintaining your dignity. So suicide is one way of controlling that as an individual. It's an age also of anxiety. I mean, this is a stressed society. There are generational conflicts. There are all these newly rich people. You know, if you're a senator's son, maintaining your status is extremely difficult. You're up against a lot of competition. So Nero's suicide is not unusual. It's interesting how it's described, that he's surrounded only again by former slaves, that he cannot even do it himself. You know, someone else has to help him push the dagger in. And that contrasts. There's a new genre of biographies after Nero's death, and it's the lives and deaths of those exiled and killed by Nero, for example. And they're all these Stoics, they're all these, you know, take calmly, take their lives and talk about philosophy and what. It's all artificial contrast. So Nero is, again, is the bad example, and these are the good guys. Also remember, Trajan, the emperor under whom Tacitus writes and possibly Suetonius, is the great nephew of one of these conspirators who are put to death under Nero or forced to commit suicide. So there's a direct link there as well.
Francesca.
Yeah, no, I mean, as Thorsten said, the whole point was when you had no other option, suicide was the honorable death. And I always found fascinating how they even took that away from him. So he took what was all the time the honorable way out, as in rather than fleeing, and since he could not fight anymore, he decided to take his own life. That's just, in theory, that's the most honorable thing he could do. But they had to represent him unable to even make that final act. He needs a freedman, I mean, not a member of the elite, a freedman to help him push the dagger in his neck. So they even took that last bit of dignity from him. I think that's quite interesting, quite telling also.
And after he died, I know there was a rash of fake Neros, of people pretending to be Nero or claiming to be Nero. And again, a very interesting question from Michael Forson. He said, apart from the ancient fake Neros, what about the modern fake Neros? What do you two think in terms of how he's been represented on film? Who is your favourite silver screen or small screen Nero?
Or shall I take it first? I think the Ustinov, still Ustinov, is great. I mean, he looks like that Capitolini portrait. He's so believable. That's why these sources are so convincing. That's why it's taken us 2,000 years to question them so hard, because they're fascinating and you can impersonate them. And, you know, Baroque opera to Hollywood movies, it's all there. I, Claudius the God, all these novels and the film adaptations, they're brilliant.
Francesca.
I guess Ustinov, it will always be a favorite. It's interesting how these fake Neros in antiquity had a mass following, as in a positive way, whereas these fake neuros, now we are discussing the more recent one, people like them, but I mean, basically they love to hate them. See, it's just a different approach, I guess. I guess all the negatives have been digested at this point, but still the anecdote, the histories, the madness, they're just, I mean, they get to you, right?
They do. We're actually at the end of our time, tragically, I know, and there are still more questions coming in. A last question to both of you. In terms of this exhibition, is there a curator's choice object? Is there one that you secretly, that you can confess to us tonight, that you secretly love above all the others?
Depends on the day. I have to say, we have received these questions many times, and I feel like every time we give a different reply. So Torsten, what's your favorite photo of the day?
Like choosing one among your children, you know? I think generally, though, our choices change, but it's not the gleaming marble statues. It's the graffiti. It's the slave chains. It's the things we don't normally see that tell us a different story and give us a different angle. And they're very touching because, you know, you could feel the slave chain around your own neck, or you can look at the little slave boy. I think they're probably, for me or for us, they're probably the best, most evocative objects in the exhibition.
Mm. And I think I have to say, one of the most remarkable objects that I've never seen up close was a mirror compact with the face of Nero on. So, I mean, it's just extraordinary, close on 2000 years old, and that could be in anybody's bag today. So, you know, remarkable treasures, as you said, moving items, mind opening, eye opening items, from the great and the monumental to the very small. So I'm afraid that's it. We have to stop. But thank you so much, both of you. You know, what total fascination, and well done. Kudos to you for getting this through in this very, very difficult time as well. As I said, there are close on 2,000 people with us tonight. I'm not sure if they'll all be able to make it to the exhibition. I know it opened to the public today. 7,000 have booked their tickets so far. But if you can make it and you can stay safe, please, please do come to the exhibition at the British Museum. And also, if you can't, join us for more online events. There are many planned throughout the autumn, and there are about 140 questions unanswered. So Francesca and Torsten, we might be able to have to come back and have a rematch with more of those questions from the public. But thank you so much for giving up your evening. Thank you so much, everybody. Thank you to the British Museum, and thank you, everybody from around the world, for joining us this evening for a night in with Nero.
Thank you.
within 6 miles to Chicago. We got a full tank of gas, half a pack of cigarettes. It's dark, and we're wearing sunglasses. Hit it.